Essentially, this is what must be developed. The art of giving out in love and intelligence what is taken in from vision on the experience of self-transcendence and solidarity with the universe. Das ist es im Wesentlichen, was wir weiterentwickeln müssen. Die Kunst, mit Liebe und Intelligenz das weiterzugeben, was wir in der Vision und in der Erfahrung der Selbsttranszendierung und des Einsseins mit dem Universum aufgenommen haben.
Ayahuasca, pharmawasca, and give them triplets. And I'm going to cover a lot of ground, and I'll try to do it with somewhat less detail than I did last week, because it was a little too long, I think, and I'll try and make it shorter this time. But it's really a big subject. First of all, I want to talk just a little bit about the Amazonian ayahuasca phenomenon, and then later somewhat about what we call ayahuasca or ayahuasca analogs. Also about pharmawasca, which is a type of ayahuasca with pure compounds instead of plant extracts. And then some of information about the snuffs, and I want to conclude with some speculations about Mesoamerica as this pertains to the cultural area that's predominant in the Mexican indigenous culture. Well, you've all heard the term ayahuasca. It's a Quechua word for the liana or vine of the souls or the spirits of the dead. And it's this plant, Gangstreopsis conopi.
What does it mean? It's focus.
The vine or liana of the soul or of the spirit. You
focus
it? No. I think you can hear me in back. Right?
Yes.
Okay. And this is growing on a jacaranda tree. It's Gangstreopsis conopi is the... Banisteriopsis conopi is the scientific name. It's in the Malpighiaceae. And we often talk about ayahuasca as a generic thing, but it's really rather a generic name for a complex of potions which only have one thing in common, basically, and that's the presence of the ayahuasca plant itself, which is this one. The vine, the stems of which, especially the lower, thicker stems, are used principally, although active compounds are found in all parts of the plant and the leaves are sometimes added. I think the plug has come loose on the back of this thing. It's on the, around the back, and that's why it's not responding. Just jiggle the plug or something. Oh, there we go. Here you can see the leaf. And this is used all over the Amazon basin. It has escaped over the Andes, the coastal areas of Colombia and Ecuador, and even up a little bit into the Panamanian area, where it's now Panama. And in the Amazon, it's basically a cultivar. Nobody can really identify true wild populations of it. And it has grows only within a few hundred meters of sea level and some degrees of the equator. Although these plants are growing at 19 degrees north latitude and 1,350 meters in Jalapa, where it does quite well. You can see the flower here, and this is flowering in Miami. Mine have never flowered, but this will give you an idea that it's adaptable to some climate areas in the United States. And many people grow it as a sacred plant. And it grows so successfully where I am that it just really knocked down in a windstorm. A very sizable tree came down from the wake. You can see this is all ayahuasca on top of it. The part that's used are the stems. That's the base of that plant you were looking at before. And this was planted outdoors in 1992, just one little piece. And so it grows quite quickly. And I'll say a little bit more about the preparation of the potion in a moment. I just wanted to show you this image. It's called Ayahuasca Visions by Juana Torres, who's here with us. He's a fantastic painter. In the Amazon, there are many different ways of preparing this. I said it's really the name for a complex of potions that only have in common ayahuasca, but also, before I talk about the potions, sometimes the crushed up stem is even smoked by itself, no additives. And in that case, it is reported by Schultes to be wrapped in leaves of heliconia or papanillo, This is a Mexican heliconia, as is this one. And the plant is actually smoked. Also, the stems are chewed, and in conjunction with snuffs. And I'll say more about trichomy-containing snuffs. I'll say more about that at the part of the presentation. But actually, this was first studied in the whole business that I will talk about monoamine oxidase inhibition and activity of tryptamines was originally proposed in the context of the snuffs, because ayahuasca, it has alkaloids been found in snuffs, and ayahuasca parts have been found in collections, ethnobotanical collections of snuff plants. And the major alkaloids are beta carbolines, of which the predominant one is harmine, and secondarily harmaline, tetrahydrocarbamine, tertiarily harmaline, in the actual vine stems. As I said, other parts of the plant contain them, and these are generically called beta carbolines. We now know them to be enzyme inhibitors, monoamine oxidase inhibitors, and I'll say more about that down the line. But in the potions, the principal compounds are harmine and tetrahydroharmine. Harmaline doesn't seem to survive the cooking process. And this is harmaline, and this is actually the most active of these MAO inhibitors. It's, in human beings, especially in the stomach, it seems to be at least double the activity of harmaline, at least in me. And the types of assays with rat liver cytosol fractions and so forth, those shows about the same MEO inhibition of harmine. Okay, well, let me talk about the potions. I said we have a complex of potions. We've identified somewhat under 100 different plants which are reported in the literature to be added to these ayahuasca potions. And we have a whole range of preparation of the potions from, in the Colombian Amazon, simply crushing the stems, infusing them in cold water, no cooking, no additives, drinking the water. That's the basic ayahuasca. That's probably the prototype in the simplest form. And then you have cooked ayahuascas ranging from cooking for about an hour and a half, 2 hours, which is typical in the Rio Purus area of Peru, also seen in the Rio Napo area of Ecuador. And then you have what's most known to people on the outside, the phenomenon of long cooking and concentration of the potions, which is common around Iquitos, Cucalpa, Tarapoto area in the Amazonian Peru. So sometimes more than one additive plant will be used. And so even if we have nearly 100 plants that are added, and we have reports of up to a half a dozen being added into any one given group. And so it's quite a big complex of potential potions, virtually an infinite number of possibilities. And the additive plants I break down into a few different categories. The first one is the catch-all category, miscellaneous. And we just don't know the biochemical or ethnomedicinal rationale for the use of many of these plants, simply because they haven't been studied chemically, biochemically, and also they're not really known in the ethnobotanical record well. But this serves as a capsule, and it's probably two-thirds of the plants fall into that, but we can conjecture that some of them are undiscovered psychotropics, and probably a great many of them, but certainly not all of them. And there are also a second category of additives, are the stimulant plants. And this slide shows the xanthine alkaloids, principally caffeine. At least two different caffeine-containing plants are added to ayahuasca. One of them is yoko, or Paulinia yoko, which contains the caffeine in the bark and is the source of a stimulating drink made from bark shavings. And it's in the same genus as guarana, Paulinia cupana, Barsorbalis. A high in caffeine, and the other one is Wayusa, which is an Ilex. Ilex Wayusa, much used in the Rio Napo and Ecuador. And in both cases, they're added to counteract the soporific effects of the ayahuasca, because it's a sedative, much like the ayahuasca alkaloids are much like Valium in their effects, and probably after the same site that's prominent for Valium in neural tissue. Besides the caffeine containing plants, coca is added to ayahuasca also, and commonly chewed along with it as a cohort. And this would more than likely be corresponding to the rhizoxylum coca bark Ipadu, which is adapted to the Amazon, especially in Colombia. It's known as Ipadu. And rather than apuyicando or sucking on quids of the leaves, the leaves are powdered, toasted powder, mixed with cecropia ash, and then ingested by the spoonful. Here you can see the flower. This is E. coca bar coca, or what's known as Bolivian coca. And sometimes, this is unusual, and I haven't seen this before, sometimes you get clusters of flowers, and they even have one that produced almost like flower top clusters, like coca buds or something like that. And I got about 100 fruits off of this, it's about a 20-year-old plant around the rock. And here you can see the berry birds like them very much. The seeds are not viable, it's very long. That complicates cultivation. These will have known, to my knowledge, ever come from the growth and cut it. So, like the caffeine-containing plants, coca has had the counteractive soporific effects of potion. And here you can see a typical Bolivian choose plant, or coca dye, and that's what the leaves in commerce look like. They're semi-dried and somewhat, there's a curing process that they go through. That's how they're carried traditionally. Now I'm going to focus on four different categories of visionary plants that are added by ayahuasca. And this is what I'm particularly interested in, because my interest is ethnopharmacognosy, especially psychotropic and especially visionary, or some would say psychoptic, and some people use other terms. But there are basically four categories we can delineate right now of vision plants added by ayahuasca. Tobacco, this is Nicotiana tobacco, and also Nicotiana rustica. This is probably the most important geographically and numerically ayahuasca cohort plant of all. And it's basically associated with the shamanic ingestion of vision plants, Pan-American, in almost all of them. Tobacco is the common element. And it's a very important one, and not to be overlooked in the pharmacology. But I have not studied that, and nobody has, to my knowledge. But we do know that tobacco itself is an MAO inhibitor. Cigarette smokers, ordinary commercial cigarettes, show about 40% MAO inhibition. So it may be significant in the pharmacology, but we just don't know. Nicotine being the major alkaloid. Here you can see the flower. This is an adventitious wild type plant from my area. And you can see Brugmansia in the background. And just starting seed of this, now it would be very difficult to eliminate. It produces a lot of seed. It's a very hardy plant. Beautiful plant. This is how it's cured and sold in the Amazon around. This was made in the real Napo area. But this is like dried tobacco leaves cured, which are then moistened with a tea of the same material, a concentrated tobacco juice, and then rolled up into this kind of lodging wrapped in leaves and bound in twine, and they were smoked like this. And this preserves it indefinitely. It's very good tobacco. You can buy these commercial simulacrum of this in Santa Cruz de la Sierra in Bolivia in the marketplace. Okay, tobacco. The second category of vision plants added to ayahuasca in the same family, Solanaceae, is Grunfelsia. And there are two different species used by a number of different indigenous groups in various parts of the plant. And we know nothing about, essentially, about the pharmacology of this, much less its interaction with the ayahuasca alkaloids. Other than to say that when, in 1977, during the Alpha Helix Amazon expedition, they did fractionation at a number of laboratories on the Amazon River. And this is known to contain abundant scopolamine, which is a coumarin compound, and it seemed to be psychoactive in animal experiments. But to my knowledge, no one has reported me yet testing this. But our best conjecture is that this scopolamine is a psychoactive constituent of Grunfelsia. But again, we don't know much about the activity of it. And this is a minor practice, not widely distributed, at least in the record that we have. The third category of vision plants, also in the Solanaceae, is Brugmansia, sometimes called tree doctoris. And this is pretty widespread, and it's also pan-Andean in association with San Pedro, or Trichocereus cactus ingestion. And the Brunfelsias are widespread all over Latin America, from South American origin. Pre-contact introduction is to Mesoamerica. This is Brugmansia sanguinea in Ecuador. And here you can see this is quite different from the ones you might have seen, and it's vegetatively very different. It's a much smaller, stiffer flower, but very potent. And now, in Ecuador, has more or less cornered the world market on these alkaloids grown from this particular plant. Formerly, they were derived in Australia from Dubois' species, but now I believe we have most of the market. This is another type of Brugmansia suaviolens. They come in different color varieties. This is the same species, but it's a color variety, and this is a really an excellent strain. It produces lots of flowers and lots of leaves. It gets very big. And that's at my place. That's pretty much in flower all year round. Very rare cases when there are flowers in it. And you can see close up of the flower. They're beautiful. The aroma mainly comes out of night. Bees love them. They make toxic cones that are psychoactive. And this is known to the South Americans. And this is Brugmansia versicolor. And this is a sort of a mutant form which has multiple corollas. And these plants are important in shamanism not only because of their psychotropic effects, but also because they transform. This is these two flowers are on the same plant. And they get what some people think may be, and this hasn't really been studied in detail, a viral infection that causes polyploidy. You get duplicate corollas, and then it advances and you get quadruplicate corollas. This is a quad here, and one of them is vestigial, and there are three there. And then the next step is they lose the morphology entirely. You get this thing that we call panuelo, or anchor sheet. But everything else, this is the same plant. That's not a cell. Okay, so the three categories I've enumerated, tobacco, Rumfelsia, Brugmansia, all in the Solanaceae. Then you have the category that most of us are more familiar with, and that are the tryptamine-containing plants, of which this one is the most widespread, Psychotria viridis, which is in the Rubiaceae or coffee family. And there is another one that's much less dispersed, which is also in the same family as ayahuasca, Diplotheris cabarani. But this is known as Amiruca Panta in Quechua. It's known as Chacruna, Chacrona in Brazil. And this is the leaves of this are added to the ayahuasca grooves in the Caribbean areas. If you know coffee, you can see the superficial resemblance. If you cut open the fruits, there are two coffee bean-like seeds. Cecropia viridis. And this is a fairly good source of DMT, which you see illustrated here. And it's not as good as other ones that we've found, though. And I'll talk more about that later. But basically, what I'm going to focus on now for the rest of my remarks on ayahuasca is the combination of chacruna leaf or oco yaque, which is Diplotheris, and Vanus curiosus, and the interactions pharmacological of tryptamine and beta carbamine. And the most important tryptamine involved in these ayahuasca additive plants that have been studied is DMT. But they also contain 5-methoxy-DMT, which is sometimes known as O-methylserotonin, and it's quite a bit more potent than DMT. But so far as we know, it seems to be a minor constituent and has not yet been reported in an ayahuasca group, to my knowledge. We don't have enough data on about 17 patients in the animals. So this is the basic formula here. We've got the ayahuasca stem, Vanus viridis canopy, and then the leaves of chacruna or amiruca planta, Psychotria viridis, combined to make the classic what ayahuasca, which is what has been adopted as diamond by the Chinese, and shawaska by the Udeveistas. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the composition and so forth. The ayahuasca plant was first studied in Colombia in the first decade of this century, and from it was isolated an alpha which was called telepatina, or telepathy, which turned out to be identical to harmony. And it was first mostly shown in this 1923 thesis from Colombia, but it wasn't until 1939 that it was shown to be harmony, which had been isolated almost a century earlier. From Tagalog Harma, from which it gets its name. I just want to show you some literature for future reference about ayahuasca, some of the most important publications. This one from 1967, U.S. government publication, Ethnopharmacologic Search for Psychoactive Drugs, has really good information also about snus, kava, amanita muscaria, and other topics. And also the books of the Colombian pedagogical writer, Bolmato, Amazonian Cosmos, there are about 10 of these. That's very interesting and very important studies with a lot of extremely good ethnography and also pharmacognostical detail.
What was the last one?
Pardon? Rifle? Bolmato. I can give it to you later if you want to spell it out for you. And the New York Botanical Garden in the Flora Neotropica series was published in 86. This taxonomic monograph of Hannes Triopsis and Digital Paris. That's the best source of, I can give you the references, I have on the slides, of taxonomic information about Hannes Triopsis species. In 1986, in the Mediashamanism, which is a Mexican publication, this is from a symposium, I think it's in Quito, and all the papers are in Ayahuasca for those who know Castilian. This is a really good, very good source, and I think you can find it sometimes in good books. Also the books of Luis Eduardo Luna, especially Vegetalismo, which is a thesis published, and again I give you the references, and this one you're probably more familiar with, Ayahuasca Visions, with some 50 paintings of Pablo Amarengo illustrating his visionary experience of ayahuasca that correlate with ethnographic information on the various plants being depicted and the types of cultural activity that are being shown. And this is a very fruitful approach that was pioneered by Rykel Goldenberg and has been taken to a higher level by Lumen and Maringo. There are several modalities of use in ayahuasca in the modern world. I'm just going to refer briefly to those and tell you which ones I focus on. We have the religious on this Latin side is there are several churches in Brazil that are legally integrated that use a form of ayahuasca, generally a simplified form, just with chacruna, or they call it chacona, and ayahuasca. But they also use some additives as well. And this has not been well studied, but I know the Udeve uses some seven, and I know what they are. And also you have ayahuasca tourism of all kinds, which I'm not much in favor of. And I try to work to make people have access to these things in their home countries so that they won't feel the need to go touristically looking for this kind of experience. You also have psychological use, therapeutic use, and that's, I think, a really solid prospect for the future world. But I don't think particularly the religious use has a great future in the world, and I hope that ayahuasca tourism does not. And I think the therapeutic modality is a winner, and also especially the psychonautic, shamanic psychonautic model, individual voyaging and self-actualization, that seems to me to be the model. There's also use of ayahuasca as a therapy for so-called drug addiction, and I think that that's a fruitful approach, but not any especially so compared to other compounds of this type, like LSD. It's not a unique thing of ayahuasca. There's a clinic, a few friends of mine in Carapoto called Takiwasa, and they publish a really excellent Castilian language journal called Takiwasa. And this is another example from Atmoyata, who does this sort of thing in Europe. There are a number of people using ayahuasca this way, and also using other things like iboga, MDMA, and so forth. I'm not going to do that. That's another subject. And the best books on the churches are these two, Diablo de la Lua by Edward McCrae, who's a Dainista and also an anthropologist in Salvador de Bahia. About the the Daime, the history of Daime, and then this is a non-commercial book from the União do Vegetal, or Udeve, about Huasca, that gives their history, but they haven't made this commercially available yet. And in my book, Pharmacotheon, this is another one of this painting is actually from the book, Ayahuasca Visions, by Pablo Amarillo. But this has an extensive information on ayahuasca, even more so in this book, Ayahuasca Analog, which I'm just now releasing in a second edition that's completely updated and a lot of the new data incorporated since its first edition in 1994. And the pharmacological and chemical side of it was recently resumed by summarized by the Shulgins and Peacock. And so that's an excellent source of information. Christian Brecht's book also on the Encyclopedia of Psychoactive Plants, thus far only available in German, that has extensive information on this topic, and especially the ayahuasca analogs, which I'm going to talk about in a moment. Trout's notes from the United States, really detailed chemical information. By the way, most of these things can be purchased if they're still in print from Mind Books in Sebastopol, California. But this has really detailed information on ayahuasca and ayahuasca alkaloids. Really detailed. And this is an example in the kind of, and this is about Jurdain, which we'll talk about in a moment. And there's also figures in both of these. And there's another one, tryptamines from higher plants, in that same series. Trout notes that anonymous out of Austin, Texas. And also there's the Entheogen Review, which is now in a new iteration. And they have a summary from past articles called Ayahuasca Analogs and Plant-Based Tryptamines, which is mostly experiential reports and basement shamanic experimentation with new formats. Now I wish to talk about ayahuasca analogs. And what I mean by that is an ayahuasca-like brew made from non-traditional source plants. Now, I said that the beta carbenes, especially harmine, of the advanced ayahuasca, are MAO inhibitors, meaning they inhibit the enzyme MAO or monoamine oxidase. And among other places, this enzyme exists in our gut, and it chews up DMT before it can be absorbed and get to your brain. But if you can inhibit it, this was the theory, it wasn't proven right away. If you can inhibit it, theoretically, DMT could get past it and make the brain be active orally. People have taken up a gram of it orally with no effect. You wouldn't want to smoke a gram of it. You burn your lungs out, one thing. But it was found, and I'll just resume this very superficially, we have only 17 analyses of ayahuasca potions, and it was discovered that they contained a range of from 40 to about 440 milligrams total beta carbenes per dose. Now, the dose fixation is, of course, a little vague. And as far as the DMT component, these were all DMT-containing potions, that it was 25 to 35 milligrams per dose over these 17 potions, with an average of 175 or so milligrams of beta carbenes and 30 of DMT. And so, as I mentioned in 67 in that book, Ethnopharmacologic Search for Psychoactive Drugs, Homestead and Linden suggested this mechanism that DMT was rendered active orally in ayahuasca by concomitant inhibition of monoamine oxidase coming from the beta carbenes that were also present in the group. But this was never put to the test. Everybody accepted it as explaining the fact that very low amounts of DMT in these potions were dramatically active. But no one really put it to the test until the mid to late 80s, when Dennis McKenna at least showed that ayahuasca brews were an MAO inhibitor in the laboratory experiments. It were effective for that, the actual brews, not the pure alkaloid. And it remained for psychonautic underground to work out the pharmacology of this. And other people have done this, and I report my own way of doing it in ayahuasca analog, and I think I was the first one to publish it. But I found in a series, I've done something like 50 or 60 experiments of this nature, using what I call pharmawasca, putting the pure compounds in capsules. I found that I started with the lowest amounts. First, I established the oral activity of DMT and found by using large amounts of Syrian reseed extract and putting DMT in it and drinking it. And I found that 20 milligrams was perceptible, and 30 milligrams for me represented an oral threshold dose for visionary effects, beginning color patterns, auditory stuff, which is the hallmark for me. And so, and then I use 30 milligrams as the key point. You want to do this kind of thing, you always want to be at the threshold, not 10 times over that, because how do you know where it either work or it won't if you're at the threshold. So then I started with the lowest amount of using pure harmine of beta carbon that's ever been reported in ayahuasca, which is 40 milligrams per dose. And I take 40 milligrams, 30 milligrams DMT, and so forth. Well, it took me about 12 experiments to get up to the harmine level that was active. And indeed, the theory held up. And for me, it took 120 milligrams of harmine, I'm expressing it as freebase, and 30 milligrams of DMT as freebase. We now know that harmaline is about twice as potent in this way. And tetrahydroharmine is a great deal weaker than this. In fact, it seems now that tetrahydroharmine shows more of a serotonin reuptake inhibition effect than an MAO inhibitor effect. And so that's an important secondary compound of ayahuasca. And usually the beta carbons are three parts harmine to one part tetrahydroharmine. and that is an SRI or a serotonin reuptake inhibitor, but a weak one. It may not be significant in the levels in them. Now, this is important because DMT and these beta carbonates are not uncommon in the botanical world. In fact, we know nearly 90 plants that contain DMT or 5-methoxy-DMT, and there are well over 100 that contain beta carbonates, but there are some around 70 that contain known MAO-inhibiting beta carbonates. And so it follows that there are many combinations of two plants that could theoretically give this ayahuasca effect by, you know, combining them so that you get an MAO inhibitor and a psychoactive tryptamine. The real pioneer in the ayahuasca analog phase was my partner in these seminars, Rob Montgomery, who also launched the shamanic plant business in 1987 with this company, Up the Jungle. And he was launching on to market in the late 80s the first attempts to nail down these ayahuasca analog plants, as we call them, to make ayahuasca. This company has since fragmented into two, BPC, the Botanical Preservation Board, which Rob still runs, and Allies, which his former partner runs, and the seed and plant businesses and Allies, and the extracts and so forth in BPC. Everything that I'm going through now is summarized in ayahuasca analogs, although I've extended the research considerably since the first edition, which is now exhausted. Immediately we fixated on Paganum harmless seed, the original source for chemists of these beta carbonates in the 1840s. Harming and harmling were isolated from the seeds of Paganum harmla, which is known as harmal also. And these are available commercially and legally pretty much all around, but in the United States they manifest like this under the name Espond or Espond. And they're sold in Middle Eastern grocery miscellaneous type stores. And they're sold like this in spice bags or seasoning bags, a typical label, and you can buy a 4-ounce spice bag for a few dollars. But shamanic plant dealers also sell them. Now these seeds contain 10 times roughly the alkaloid level, the beta carbonyl level of the Vanisteriopsis stem, although of course there's considerable variation from strain to strain and so forth. But normally what people do and what we have done to make an ayahuasca analog and what seems to be safe and account for all of the strain variation is set a dose level of 3 grams as enough to affect MAO inhibition in the stomach. I will talk about this one later, so just skip over that. And then the tryptamine part proved to be the tougher nut to crack. Rob first launched, I think the first one that was actually put out commercially, and this was many years before my book came out in 94, was Desmanthocillinoensis, or the Illinois bundleflower, which contains DMT and 5-methoxy-DMT and bufotenin and other tryptamines in the roots. And this works, but it proved to be fairly low amounts of tryptamines, roughly about what is in psychotria, though. And people were also, the shamanic plant dealers began to sell psychotria leaf and Vanisteriopsis. So people began in the late 80s to brew ayahuasca in the United States. And we've looked for a lot of other tryptamine sources, and I just want to run through a few of them here that I, some of you may have experimented with. This is an Australian acacia medianii, which have been reports out of Australia, and that's a place where early activity of this kind went on. Roughly, wouldn't you say contemporaneous with the U.S. ayahuasca analog? And I mention that because Australia is also one of the first places where we have any evidence of non-traditional psilocybin mushroom use outside of wild Mexican first thing. And I think from there it spread through surfers to Bali and Thailand. And so that's just a conjecture. So this is acacia medianii. That's from seed in about 3 years, I think. So 5 or 6 liters almost. Good tryptamine source. This one unfortunately died on me. This is on the case of Simplicifolia or Simplex from New Caledonia. Also one of the richer ones, nearly 1% DMT has been reported in some plant parts. From now on, I will focus on this one, which is Mimosa. Here you see hospice, but it's really Mimosa tenuiflora. The same genus, or family rather, as Acacia, of leguminosae, the legumes. And it's best known indigenous name is Jurema Preta, which is, means the black Jurema. That's what it's called in Brazil. And this has become more or less the the standard commercial way of making ayahuasca analogs at home. And so people will generally now use Tagalog harmless seed for the beta carotenes and the root bark of this plant, which is my most attended flora. This is growing in Mexico. It grows over a vast range, probably the total area that covers is substantially larger than the United States. And it grows maybe as far north as Baja California, because there are people exporting something out of there that they call Jadema, but it's not reported botanically. And its farthest northern reach in the botanical literature is the coast of Oaxaca. And it grows all the way down the coastal Caribbean through the Caatinga of northeast Brazil and almost to the southern border of Brazil on the Atlantic coast, below Bahia. And this is in Oaxaca, Mexico. And I'm just going to run through these fairly quickly. I have more pictures of it down the line. But it's a very hardy, dry, tolerant plant. And this is growing in an area where almost nothing else will grow, where they evaporate the ocean water and make sea salt. And the ground is very salty. It rains very seldom. And you can't even kill them. You can take off a taproot and it regrows from the lateral roots. I don't know if you can see the spiny nature of this picture a little bit. Anyway, it was very windy. I couldn't get those pictures, but I have better ones down the way, and I'll show them to you. But this is Mimosa tenuiflora, best known as Mimosa hospis, Jurema preta. And that's what the commercial root bark looks like. And it's about 1% DMT, but strains as high as 11% have been analyzed, but it's not reported in the literature yet. 1% DMT, roughly, is the Mexican material. And so my typical dosage form, and Rob will talk more about this specific preparation, is 3 grams of Ganem harmless seed crushed up in a mortar, 10 grams of Jurema preta root bark, and Rob will go into the actual brewing of it. So this kind of summarizes there with ayahuasca, some people call it Mimowasca or Jurema wasca, and that's the amount of plant material you need for one dose. And remember, both of these are considerably stronger alkaloids than the Amazon prototypes. So even though this is an analog, from a natural products chemical perspective, this is a more desirable situation. If you're starting with higher concentrations, you need to use less plant material, and if you're going to have to swallow it, you know, you need to use less water to extract it. And this is important because this stuff is not going to replace champagne and hot chocolate. Okay. Now, it happens that this plant, Jurema preta, has a history all of its own, apart from ayahuasca. And this man, Osvaldo Gonzalez de Lima, a Brazilian microbiologist who worked most of his career in Mexico, actually, has written some very important Mexican books, went to a place in Pernambuco near the border of Bahia, the Rio San Francisco, called Tacaratu, and studied the phenomenon of a potion called Vinha da Jurema, the wine of Jurema, or Jurema wine. Jurema is a Tupi word. Vinha is Portuguese, of course, for wine. Jurema is a Tupi word, and it refers to a kind of a forest spirit who manifests as a beautiful Indian woman with a jaguar. And there are icons of this that they sell. And this was a once probably a very widespread practice, but from all evidence, it would more or less disappear before 1946 when it was studied in its pristine form. And this was the first attempt really to study it. But this is called Observations on Vinho da Jurema, utilized by the Pancaraguru Indians of Tacaratu. And in 46, he observed the preparation of the potion, documented it, and it was simply, just like in Colombia with ayahuasca, the crushed root bark infused in cold water, squeezed a little bit, skim the foam, filter it, and drunk in the actual ceremony. No cooking, no additives. Now, this is the area looking south of Bahia. And he isolated a compound from this, which he called Nigerina, or Nigerine. And from the empirical formula that he gave, we might conjecture that it could have been an impure form of DMT, perhaps contaminated with DMT and monoxide. But it was never effectively characterized until 1959, when working from material sent by Gonzalez de Lima, chemist at the Pfizer company in Connecticut, isolated DMT in high yield from the roots, about 0.6% isolated from this. And so that was in 1959. But Gonzalez de Lima's report in 1946, were it DMT, would have been the first discovery of DMT as a natural product. It waited until 1955 before it was specifically characterized from an anthanthera seed pod, and also in the United States. That 59 paper is really important. I think I have it illustrated here. This is the 46. It's only in Portuguese. This one. Because it also represents not only the identification of probable synonymy between nitrogen and DMT, but it also represents the first isolation of 5-methoxy-DMT as a natural product of dictyolona and incandescens. And furthermore, there was a study of pyptidenia or anadenanthra colubrina, which Manolo will be talking about, associated. So you have three biggies, that, you know, all of which I'm going to talk about now. There's one 59 paper in JAX, the American Chemical Society. Well, here you can see the thorny nature. This is a botanical drawing. This is called espinado, also. Generally speaking, here they would say uña de gato, which is a generic name for any legume with cat's claws, its spines. Everyone associates uña de gato with Untaria, which is, there's an Untaria in the ayahuasca additive complex in the Rubiaceae. But that's used for a lot of things, so be careful here with things that they call uña de gato, because this is one of them. And this gives you an idea of the kind of ecosystem in which it grows. This is fulmio, also in Pernambuco, very common, and there are many of these trees are what they would call jurema, but there's only one jurema preta. And this is the marks the border between Bahia and Pernambuco, the Rio San Francisco. And this is the area, and this is just loaded with interesting legumes. Now, let me say a few things about what this jurema means, beautiful place. Jurema preta refers to specifically Mimosa tenuiflora, Mimosa hospitalis. But they also recognize other types of jurema, of which the most commonly called jurema branca, or the white jurema. And there are 11 species in all that are, besides tenuiflora, that are called jurema. There are mimosas, acacias, pithecelobium, and vitex. There's only the vitex, the only non-legume among them. And they're all good candidates for tryptamines. And ethnographically, this practice has more or less disappeared, and at the same time is more widespread than ever, and I'll explain what I mean by that. What Gonzalez de Lima observed, the preparation of this basic potion, this aqueous extract of the Mimosa tenuiflora root bark, has almost disappeared. It's only been reported once by a friend of mine from the Achicum area of Pernambuco, not far from Bacaratu. But in that case, he, who did his thesis on this, was a Brazilian anthropologist, found that it was not psychoactive in the doses that they gave to him. There was no additive, there was just this extract. And there's a thesis studying this. It's now been reported anthropologically in about a half a dozen places, but it's clearly a degenerated tradition, more or less like ayahuasca, but more so degenerated. And no one's reported, an active dose from this. And another friend, Clarice Novaes da Mota, did her thesis on this at UT Austin in 1986, and Jurema Cola. It's in the back. Okay, there we go. Here you can see the flower. I'll just run through these quickly. Cluster is a flower. This flower is in the winter for there, but in August. And And Clarice studied this ethnobotanically in the ethnobotany of the Caridi Shoko, which are the Caridi especially, one of the groups associated with Aim and Jepson. And they only made the potion from Mimosa varicosa, which is one of the Jurema brancas, although they call it Jurema mansa, the tame Jurema. And it was not active, and the Jurenero, the curandero from the Caridi, told her, well, because you're not an Indian, you won't feel. Frankly, that kind of thing always makes me suspicious. And I think that the potion should speak for themselves, and I don't understand that notion, but indeed she didn't feel it, nor have these psychoactive treatments been reported from that plant, despite many affirmations of the contrary in the literature. You haven't found any primary chemical report of that. So Cristina was here this week, and I were in Brazil this summer, chasing around trying to establish connections in the various areas where this had been reported, and talking to people who had studied it in depth. And my suspicion is that basically it's such a degenerative tradition that they've more or less lost the connection, the dosification, something, or something missing. And I decided to put it to the test. This is from Mexican Jurema. By the way, let me just say parenthetically, here this plant, this Mimosa tenuiflora, is called Tepescohuite, which means, it's from Nahua, Tepescohuite, means ironwood. Very strong wood. And Tepescohuite is probably the most famous non-psychoactive here medicinal herb in Mexico. And they just take the stem bark powder and it's put as a vulnerary and a burn treatment on wounds. And we don't have any evidence that the Mesoamericans, the Mayans, or any of these groups discovered the psychoactivity of this plant. There's, and I know this literature pretty well and I have it at home. And I'm pretty clear that they didn't. And there's no hint in any of it that there was something more to this or even an oral ingestion of it. So that is also something that's commonly sold in the U.S., and that's another reason why this is a good source of ayahuasca analysts. It's a famous medicinal plant that's not known to be psychoactive from Mexico, and it can be sold under the name of Tepescohuite. I decided to put this to the test, and I've taken various doses, so I'll show you how the Jurema Preta is made. This is 25 grams of the root bark. Again, remember I told you of the same strain, I will take 10 grams as a basic dose, not so strong for me, with the scallion seed. So the stem, the bark, root bark is simply crushed with a stone, just like ayahuasca stems are often prepared, the same 25 grams, put it in a bowl that has a disembodied eye on the bottom. And then just plain well water, and it's squeezed a little bit in the hands, which is another common method for producing these sorts of things. And it yields this kind of potion, which is, you can see why it's called vinho da Jurema. It looks rather like red wine. In fact, it's probably an important dye plant, but we're not much up on that. And so I simply drank it to see what the effect would be. And indeed, it is active orally without any additive plants. There's 25 grams, which would theoretically contain about 250 milligrams of DMT, something like that, a non-orally active dose. The analysis of this plant that was done in Brazil by Homestead and scientists from the Paraíba, Raul Pessoa, showed fairly clear, clean DMT spike
I want to have it crystal wrapped and wear it on.
That's probably about several grams. I don't know how many of it.
Is this what your custom said?
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, so, that being the case, and remember, we knew about DMT and this from about 1959 up. In many of Schulte's books, this is some more really key literature here, the botany and chemistry of hallucinogens, hallucinogenic plants, gold light, and plants of the gods, as about the only one that's talked about this, we know very little about it outside of Brazil. But the Brazilian literature, as far as pharmacognosy and ethnobotany is concerned, is not very illuminating, and there are no bioassay reports or anything. And so it has commonly been said in this literature, this is the thesis I referred to on the Cardini Choco, where she did take the Jurema Mansa approach of nothing. Rodrigo Brunerval, who studied this in the Achikun, and also Marco Fromboni have ingested it from the Mimosa tenuiflora and also reported to be inactive. They reported that in this one area where we know that they still survive the use of the hospitals or tenuiflora, that they use large amounts of suco de maracuja with it, which is the juice of the passion fruit, maracuja. Here we say maracuja. And they speculated this is a known source of beta carbones.
What plant is it?
Passiflora incarnata.
What's the common white name?
The passion flower. Or passion fruit. But here it's known by the Brazilian name maracuja. And it's commonly prepared and buy it on the sidewalks and stuff all over Brazil and the cities and so forth. But he said they were taking large amounts of this juice with it and speculated that there was some kind of a beta-carboline connection, that monoamine oxidase inhibition was being induced by the super of maracuja in order to make the DMT in the jurema orally available. Get from the brain, orally active. This is what the fruit looks like. And the juices are made from the pulp around the seeds inside. It's delicious. It's one of my favorites. And it contains principally harmin, which is also called passiflorane, but it also contains harmin and harmin in much lower amounts than many other beta carbons. But to my knowledge, no one has ever reported using this as an MAO inhibitor pharmacologically. And I don't know, I said last week that to my knowledge, nobody had shown the alkaloids in the actual juice, but that has in fact been shown. And so it's a feasible theory. So they were looking for a missing ingredient here, and that's entirely possible, that there is a missing ingredient. And even when Gonzalez de Lima first studied it, that had been lost. But he did, in fact, did not take the potion. It was a real problem with this kind of stuff. And you know, the shaman went into trance, but what does that tell us pharmacologically? Not too much. This is another Brunfelsi again. There's a possible cross connection between ayahuasca and the additive plant issue. The most important one is this business of the Jurema Branca, four of which I think are Pithecilobium species in the Luminosi, and some Pithecilobium species are ayahuasca additive plants and may add tryptamines to it. We don't know, they haven't been studied. But there was one report from the last 1880s about a Jim Jones-type character in a rural part of Brazil. I forget what state it was in. But in this area, who flipped his wig, kind of, and he had his flock out in a very remote area. And he prepared a jurema potion using cachaça or aguardiente, cane alcohol, instead of water. The jurema, and then he loaded it up with Brunfelsia uniflora, which is called manaca, and is an important ethnomedicine in Brazil. And it's loaded with scopolamine, and it's quite toxic. But anyway, the people went crazy, and many of them sacrificed themselves and their own children. Many people were killed before the party was broken up. But that Brunfelsia, the fact that Brunfelsia is associated with that report, may indicate some vestigial connection to jurema past before this was ever documented. I should mention also in this context that this vast area over which this grows, just in Brazil, it's probably two-thirds the size of the United States, the range of this plant. And there are not very many indigenous peoples. All of Brazil only has 150,000, and the most that are in any one state are something like 30,000. I forget whether it's Paraíba or Pernambuco or Bahia. And there's been some of the indigenous groups today aren't really indigenous groups because it's an area where there's extensive Afro-American culture, some Portuguese, and some indigenous. And many groups band together for political reasons to define themselves as indigenous groups to get protection for their land under federal legislation, I think it was in the 1940s. And it happens that the Achikum, the area where it's the only place today where anyone says that they still take Mimosa tenuiflora extract, is one of those areas. And there's some polemic on it, but the consensus is that it's not an indigenous group. They set up that way to get protection under this law, and learned a certain type of ritual. There were actually itinerant dance teachers that went around at this time and showed a certain type of dancing to people that wanted to do this to prove to the government experts that they were an indigenous group, so they would get protection for their land under this law. This is what I mean by it's really a degenerated tradition in this area, and things aren't what they seem. Tobacco is also intimately associated with this. And just like it's the same as an ayahuasca preparation, the few primary reports we have, tobacco is smoked constantly, blown over the potion while it's being prepared, blown over the cup of potion before it's taken, and so forth. And I mentioned tobacco itself is an MAO inhibitor, and we don't yet know why. This was reported in Nature about a year ago. But 40% MAO-B inhibition has been shown in tobacco smokers in the United States. Tobacco smoke is known to contain very low levels of beta carbon. We don't know if that's significant in this particular context. But tobacco is another intimate link. But as I said, that's common in all the shamanic plant traditions. And this is a very good book about the modern situation and the catching bowls of the pipe, which we have one that may be made out of the end of the manthra wood. And I won't go into this subject now because a lot of interesting connections between the snuff complex and the ayahuasca. And that's something the Molo and I are looking at now. So, and here's Lou Homestead when he was in Paraíba in the 83 with a Jure Negra who prepared the potion for him, and then it was reanalyzed with modern methods both in Brazil and in Sweden. And this particular strain, which is from Alhambra in Paraíba, which is outside of the range of the plant, and there's a secondary cult of Jure Negra, which is today more important, and it's a type of a syncretic church in which the Jure Negra is just a symbol, and the drug of choice is alcohol. And there are several good studies, and no one has ever seen like a vision-type potion associated with it. They're all called Jurema, and they're called Jurenegros. And in Alhambra, it's especially associated with this, and there are lots of Jurema trees there, but they don't naturally grow there. This is a modern post-contact phenomenon. But they found 11% DMT in this strain from which this woman made, which Jurema made the potion. And the potion contains something just under 7.5 milligrams of DMT per milliliter. And so it's hard because we don't know the dosage information and so forth, but it makes it something like 15 to 60 times the DMT concentration that has ever been reported in ayahuasca. So there's been this speculation about the missing ingredient and so forth, but it turns out that there is none, because it's active just as it is. And I always knew in my heart that that was going to be the case, because of I just felt that to be the case, because the report of the early making of the potion was so clear and well documented from a pharmacognostical perspective, and there was no particular attitude, and the context was such that it seemed like a genuine thing to me. So I drank this potion, this extract, made two cold water extracts, just squeezing and letting it stand, 25 grams prepped for about 15 minutes each time, filtered through a Melitta filter, and drank it. And it was indeed just like an ayahuasca analog, only slightly altered pharmacodynamics and no feeling of MEO inhibition. So how can we explain this? This is something we're working on. A colleague of mine, Jace Calloway, in Europe and Finland at the moment. But it does not contain beta carbons. There have been a half a dozen different analyses, and no one's ever found beta carbons in it. And there's the possibility that there's some other category of natural monoamine oxidase inhibitor in the plant. But to me, I know this stuff really well. It doesn't feel like MEO inhibition. And the altering in the pharmacodynamics, which is, I won't go into, suggest to me that that's the reason, because there is no step of inhibiting monoamine oxidase. But anyway, what we found so far is there are at least five different DMT adducts or complexes in this extract, and three DMT occurs, but there are bound forms of DMT which we're working on identifying now. But the conjecture that we're working with is that the bound forms of DMT, in other words, the DMT is complex to a larger molecule like somatriptan, pharmaceutical, and it it's large enough and there's some kind of a blocking at the active site of the enzyme, but it cannot be acted upon by monoaminoxidase. Yet it is nonetheless absorbed from the stomach. And then the free DMT would either have to be generated in the process of absorption or in the brain, because I think it would have to be as free DMT in the brain. But all of this we can get at first by identifying the adducts. But it seems like through this we can get a handle on some way of rendering these tryptamines orally active without having to take a monoaminoxidase inhibitor with them. And this is important because the monoaminoxidase inhibitor inhibits the effect of the tryptamine. It enables it to get into your out of your stomach and into the brain, but in the brain its action is more or less opposed to DMT, and that's why it's much less active orally than it is by other routes. And it, even with correlating blood levels, this has now been done. And in other words, an equivalent blood level of DMT in ayahuasca, this was shahuasca that was used with human subjects in Manaus, a certain blood level of DMT in ayahuasca compared to the same blood level of DMT injected intravenously in ayahuasca is perceived as being considerably less potent. So we know it's not an artifact of how much is being absorbed, so that it is in fact weaker this way. Okay, now I want to talk briefly about pharmawaska, and then I'll go rapidly into the snuffs. This shows, you know, harmony and DMT as a pharmawaska on chacruna leaf and ayahuasca leaf. And it's been made in experimentally with harmonine, and a couple of other beta carbolines. And the tryptamines that have been tried so far are DMT, 5-methoxy-DMT, and glufotinin has not been tried, DMT, 5-methoxy, and diethyltryptamine, which is an artificial tryptamine not yet reported in nature, and diethyl instead of dimethyl, two extra carbon. But the one that I use in ayahuasca analog is harmine with DMT as pharmacological. I'm starting a company in Amsterdam that actually started, and we're introducing a legal pharmacological analog. It's a legal form of pharmacological, which has two different pills, and one of them contains harmaline, which is the most active MEO inhibitor in the beta carbolin series in the human gut as far as we can tell in these kind of experiments. 60 milligram dose. It's a minimal dose for most people to get sufficient MEO inhibition to get the DMT out of their stomachs. And that's what you want. You don't want any more than that if you're looking for the activity of the tryptamines in the brain. I should mention that in the context of Amazonian healing, this is not what they're looking for. They're not looking for the digits. They're looking for the body power that comes through the ayahuasca analogs. They use 10, 20, even 30 times more higher doses of beta carbolines in jungle ayahuasca, in part because of the purgative effect. It's a very important purgative, and it's even called generically La Purga. But there are reports from various ayahuasca-using shamans in Amazonia that say things like the healing power comes from tobacco and ayahuasca. The chacruna, or the DMT plant, just gives a little light to illuminate the situation. The shuar, even told a close colleague of mine who speaks shuar and has spent much time with them studying their use of ayahuasca, which they call natem or natema, he was told specifically in the context of acting temporarily as a sort of shaman's apprentice, that the visions were not what it was all about because it was a distraction and not to pay attention to them. And so they don't, it's not focused around the vision, but something that's in the body. And remember, the shaman's principal duty in this context is healing, not exclusive. So, and 5-methoxy-DMT happens to be about 5 times more active than DMT, and it's legal. So, we're going in the next couple of months, and we have prototypes of this here if anyone wants to try it, commercialize this out of Europe. And it can be sold legally, and it will be sold very discreetly through shamanic plant dealers and through the therapeutic community, because we don't wish to attract attention to this, but to make it available to people. And so it will be sold as 2 different products with no claims made for it at all. And one of them is the natural herbal tonic, which is 10 milligrams of 5-methoxy-DMT. These are legal in the U.S., by the way, also. and the natural herbal relaxant, which is the harmony in 60 milligram dose. So these will be commercialized within a couple months. And okay, now I wish to discuss the snus, because that's the other piece, and another piece yet, and it's tripping me puzzling. Again, this book is a really important source for information on two different kinds of tryptamine-rich snus, which I will discuss in turn, and this is where the theory of the ayahuasca effect was first launched in this book, published by the United States government, by the way. No copyright, superintendent of documents, $4, it's the best deal we've ever gotten out of our government, I think. And this book also, by Rachel Dolmatov, The Shaman and the Jaguar, is a really good source of information on snus and ayahuasca in Colombia, also, this book by Desmet, Ritual Enemas and Snuffs of the Americas, in the Americas, 1986, out of print, unfortunately. And Manolo Torres' book, The Iconography of South American Snuff Trays, from the Ethnological Studies Series of the Gothenburg Ethnographic Museum. And Manolo will be talking in much greater detail about this. And I'm going to talk briefly about two different kinds of tryptamine-containing snuffs. The first one, this is the Waikā people of Brazil and Venezuela, sometimes more commonly known as Yanomamo. And they prepare both kinds of snuffs that I'm going to talk about, but the one that they use most and it grows in their area is what is generically known as Ebena or Ebena, Nyakwana. It has various names. And it's administered like this, through a blowgun-like apparatus at the end of which is packed with them, and it's just shot into both nostrils. This is also from our government's publication, and this illustrates the dramatic effects of it. And this plant, this is prepared from that reddish bark up there, and you can see the red extract. And that's a bark of the marola tree, and the Myristicaceae, the nutmeg. And there are about a dozen or 13 of these that have been shown to contain psychoactive tryptamines, and a half a dozen maybe that are recorded in ethnographic reports as being used in snuff preparations. And in this case, the principal compound is 5-methoxy-DMT. There are low levels of DMT, which are probably not particularly significant in the effect of the snuff. But what they do is they strip the bark from the trees fresh, and then a red resin is exuded, which you see in that vial on the piece of bark. And the resin is then dried and powdered, and that's the snuff powder. And it's fairly high amounts of 5-methoxy-DMT have been found in this, sometimes at above 10%. And I go back to a slide of ayahuasca because I want to reiterate what I said before, that ayahuasca is also associated with these snuff plants, especially the Virola. And there are a couple of collections where there are ayahuasca stand with Virola bark as source plants under the snuff sample, and harmine and harmling, which are more or less, they're fairly not so broadly distributed as some of the other beta carbons, are more or less signature alkaloids for Vanus thuriopsis in South America, and they have also been found in high amounts in the snuffs. So the snuffs, and this is something that I'm studying right now, the nasal pharmacology of tryptamines, and these snuffs, and I'm intending to model the snuffs with 5-methoxy-DMT and also the bufotenin, which I'll discuss in a minute. As I did with the tryptamines in ayahuasca. So it's also related to the ayahuasca phenomenon. There are other plants that are added to the snuffs. This one is called Justicia pectoralis in the Ethnopharmacologist, and it's very aromatic. It contains coumarins, but there is a report of tryptamines, DMT, from this plant, but it hasn't been confirmed, and there is reason to suspect the possibility of contamination from the Virolas, which are being collected at the same time, and it needs to be studied further. But the Justicia is made into a snuff by the Waikā itself, which is called Nashahari. So this is possibly adding DMT to the 5-methoxy-DMT, which is in the Virola bark, and which also contains low levels of DMT in some species of protein and other tryptamines. So in that sense, here you see the ingredients of the Firmawasca, which are also kind of the ingredients of Virola snuff, probably, in the overall phenomenon, the beta carbolene and 5-methoxy-DMT. And you can see the flower. This is Justicia pectoralis again, the 8-methoxy. And this is a good bet for tripping plant on the neck. It's not, it's on the right, it's the dry powdered leaf. And our old friend.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to discuss another type of snuff, and then I'm going to have a few rapid speculations on the Mesoamerican situation, and then I'll stop. Anadenanthra is another leguminous genus, like Mimosa. And Manola is going to be talking pharmacologically and experientially more about this. I won't say too much about it, and it's something that I haven't yet gotten from still at the 5-methoxy at the moment. But the study of this phenomenon, which is northern South American, Caribbean, South Andean, and perhaps northern Argentina, southern Brazil, it is best summarized in this book, the genus Anadenanthra of Amerindian cultures. These Anadenanthras were once classified as Pictodenians, but Anadenanthra is the currently accepted taxonomy by Siri von Reis-Altschul, now at the New York Botanical Garden, and this book again contains significant information about this plant. This is Salta in northern Argentina, and this illustrates one of these important species, which is Anadenanthra colubrina var sedil. And the snuff prepared from the seeds of this plant is generically known as sedil. And this is the city of Salta, and that's the Precordillera de los Andes, and this is the capital of the state of Salta in northern Argentina, on the border with Bolivia. And this is the plant in the foreground, and this is a mountain called San Bernardo in the center of town, which you can go up on a telephone, and the whole mountain is pretty much covered with this, as are most of the mountains for a good radius around the city. It's not an uncommon thing at all. And this is right at the Tall Creek Station. We sampled this particular tree because we knew we could find it again. Here you can see the flower. It's quite a bit different from the flower, but not so much the leaf structure from the mimosa. And of an anthropolubrina var sedil. And I'll leave to Manolo to say more about the ethnography of the snuff, because I know he goes into it, but and he will talk a lot about these artifacts. That it's the seeds of this Anadenanthra colubrina var sedil that are used to prepare the snuff. And one of these trees, they're not large trees, would have some hundreds of pods on it in a good year. And a good pod would contain a dozen of these seeds. And properly prepared, a dose might be only one seed, or two, or a few. And so this is not like mushroom hunting. You've just got, you know, the whole mountain's covered. You can go up in the cable car, chewing coca, drinking mate, and then you just scope them out down below, and you don't have to get muddy and stuff. It's really kind of like gentlemanly working conditions. But so, and it's very common, and these are now being commercialized in the shamanic plant market, and I know there will soon be some really good snuff products made from this seed. And that was a replica of this particular snuff tree, and Manola is going to talk about these. This is probably Anadenanthra wood. This is from northern Chile, from San Pedro de Atacama. But I'll just show you some examples, and I'll leave it to Manolo to talk about this. They're really beautiful artifacts, and these are snuff tablets. They're probably Anadenanthra snuff, almost certainly, and we have a strong evidence for that. That one's from northern Argentina, from Picarda. So what we have observed in bioassays and so forth, and in field work, the seeds are simply toasted slightly to make them a little crispy, crushed, not really finely powdered, and smoked with tobacco. And they're more active, apparently, according to the shaman, smoke than snuff. But even today, when they're used primarily smoking, they snuff small amounts of it, kind of to keep faith with the tradition, which, as you will find out from Manolo, has an uninterrupted history of something like 4 millennia in this area, and is one of the best documented and long-lasting into modern times evidence we have on this sort of thing. This is another very good book by Henry Vassen, The Use of Some Specific Kinds of South American Indian Snuff and Related Paraphernalia, same series as Manolo's book, which you see here came out about 10 years later. And this is a painting from Donna Torres, which is from San Pedro de Atacama, looking at the Paso de Jaman in Argentina. But Manolo will put this in context, but this is all related to Anadenanthra colubrina var sedil. And again, Manolo will go into this, but the main, I'll just say chemically speaking, We found in these seeds, from about a half a dozen samples from northern Argentina, from around Salta and from around Tartagá, from about 2.5 or 3% up to about 14% bufotenine, and almost no other alkaloids. Trace amounts of some other tryptamine, no DMT, no 5-methoxy-DMT, although both have been isolated from pods of another species of Amaranth. And we don't know anything really about the pharmacology of bufotenine. That's next up for me, except for some unethical experiments that were done on prisoners in the Ohio State Penitentiary in 1956 and on mental patients in New York State in 1959, which was injected intravenously in fairly high doses into people and showed, in one case, they said it turned their colors, their faces the color of an eggplant. And in the other study, it said it turned their faces the color of a plum. So it gives you an idea of the dramatic cardiovascular effects of injecting this stuff in your bloodstream. But some of those kind of effects are shown from smoking or intranasal application. Because remember, bufotenine is 5-hydroxy-DMT. Serotonin is 5-hydroxy-T. We know the DMT, but just without the two methyl groups. And bufotenine, of all these compounds, is the closest one to serotonin. And it's an isomer of psilocin. Psilocin is 4-hydroxy-DMT and is active orally. Bufotenine is 5-hydroxy-DMT, and we don't know if it's active orally, frankly, but I'm going to find out. And so it's called serotonin, 5-hydroxytryptamine, because sero, blood, tonin, pressure, tone, because there are lots of serotonin receptors in the bloodstream and in the vascular system, and also on platelets. It's very important in the circulatory system, and so it's not a good idea to inject bufotenine or serotonin IV, and I certainly wouldn't do that. And I use that painting on the cover of another book, that's why I show it. And it's on the wall of my office now. Okay, before finishing up with the anodinanthra, again, Manola will give you a lot more detail. There was another species. There are actually two species with two varieties of each. And along the savannas of the Caribbean coast of North America and in more recent times in the Caribbean itself, there was a large widespread use of a snuff made from this plant, Anodinanthra peregrina var peregrina, also known as pitivinia, sometimes in literature, also prepared from the seeds, which also contain bufotenine in lower levels, but not a lot of other stuff. And this is best known by the name Yoko. Yoko, the Waika call it Hisioma. They also use it, but they have to go to the savannah to get it and trade for it. But they prefer it to their own indigenous Epena smith, the 5-methoxy-DMT one, because it's more potent, probably also easier to keep long term in where they live. And you can see the seeds look very much like the Anodinanthra colubrina seeds. And we have fairly sketchy data on the preparation, but this is a collection that Richard Spruce made in the Orinoco of a mortar and pestle and a carrying implement and a double snuff tube. And this is unfortunately more or less disappeared. It still survives. It's sort of like the Jurema thing in a few areas, but it's imperative that we get more information about this on an ethnographic level. In the Caribbean, among the Taino people, which have disappeared completely, but were the first indigenous peoples to be studied by Europeans, by Pané, who was left on La Española by Colón, by Columbus, and went back and left him there to study this, and he learned Taino. There it was used with this kind of implement, which is called a semí. And there was a table, it's like a table height thing, with a smooth hardwood platform on the top, and it was snuffed on top of that, probably through a snuff tube. There wasn't a snuff kit with it. And these were undoubtedly in some kind of temple. And there's always associated the erect phallus with this, and I think the bufotenine is going to prove to be the herbal super Viagra. That's my feeling. It's some Viagra that will really work. I'm going to drop the anodinanthra because Manolo has a lot to say about that. And I don't want this to run too late. I want to talk a little bit about Mesoamerica, what's now Mexico, and some speculations about this. Now, it's always struck me as strange that in the Mesoamerican area, centered around where Mexico City is now, going mostly through northern Mexico, down about to the Mayan area, that's what we call Mesoamerica, we know some dozen or so chemical pharmacological categories of psycho of vision plants. And there were representatives of about eight of those just in the pharmacopoeia of the Nahuatl speakers in Mexico. So they were real experts on this. And we know that they made snuffs. We know that they made enemas. But we don't have any solid evidence connecting a known surviving practice or historical record connecting a known tryptamine plant with them. Short-acting tryptamines. Of course, psilocin is a tryptamine, but that's orally active. I'm referring to these ones where some kind of snuffing or MAO inhibition, DMT, 5-methoxy-DMT, bupropion, there are sources for them here, but we don't have any solid evidence that they were used or that there are names that suggest that or, you know, and there's a lot of history of this stuff here. And so in Mesoamerica, the entheogen complex centered around a type of an ayahuasca potion, which is an all-purpose vehicle for administering inebriating plants as well as ordinary medicines. And here there were two. One of them was the cacao potion, or cacao, not sweet and no milk, water, cacao, sometimes cornmeal and other plants, to which were added various psychoactive plants and also ordinary medicaments. And the other one was ocli, which you see in this pot on the top, or today called pulque, which is a word of obscure etymology. And that's the fermented sap of the agave plant, which I'll show you here, and I'll back up. This is agave salmiana. Many different species are used to make this, and I'll say a few words about that in a minute. Now, this pot up here is called the tochtecoma. And could somebody focus that a little bit? The ocli potion is always like white and foamy. It foams by itself. And if you go to a pulqueria today, you can see this. It's only drunk fresh. It doesn't keep. And what you see on the top of that are flowers, and that indicates psychoactive additives, iconographically, to the potion. Xochitl in Nahuatl means roughly entheogenic. It means flower. But metaphorically, in terms like Xochinanacatl, which means literally flower mushroom, it means entheogenic mushroom. And here you see stylistically depicted on a throne the agave plant. And this woman is Mayawa, who's an historical personage that was subsequently deified. And the rabbit is the sign of inebriation in Mesoamerica. And the reason for that is during the two-century migration of the Nahuatl-speaking Mexicas, which anthropologists call Aztecs, which is a made-up word, is all historically recorded. They were Chichimecas, they came from the north, and then eventually settled in what is now the Valley of Mexico. But along the way, over a couple of centuries, in probably around Hidalgo, and nobody really knows for sure, they observed rabbits going up to the base of the stems of the agave. I mentioned this the other day, hollowing them out and so forth. This was the woman that made that observation. And then the rabbits would come back a couple days later and drink the fermented sap. So they started doing this, and they discovered this potion through the rabbit. So the rabbit symbolizes this for them. And the yacamestli, this nose ring that she has, represents the moon, which is also associated with the rabbit. And they always have the rabbit in the moon, not the man in the moon. And these are signs of inebriation. In the Maya area, the equivalent of this is the chacmol, which is the god of the opti-type potion, who had a bowl on his stomach and was filled with this. And this is you've probably seen the flower. That's the same plant. When I got back from 2 months in Europe, that thing had grown, you know, in that time. They only flower once, and then they expire. There are many species used. Many of you are familiar with mezcal or tequila, which is a type of mezcal. Mezcal is the generic name for distillates made from these fermentations of the agua miel or the sap of the agave. This is agave marginate of our Americana. And there's one in particular. Tequila is made especially from one species in particular called agave tequillense. But a number of them are used to make these grooves, these okli or huite grooves. Now, here you can see the rabbit coming out of the Tochtico mountain and the foam running all over the flowers, representing the entheogenic additives, and he's underscoring the point by holding the flowers in his hand. And this thing with the spear and the flag penetrating the thing is still obscure to me, and I don't know if anyone's ever come up with any halfway rational explanation of that. But in this panel, you see another Oakley potion that also contains cacao, because cacao is brown foam, and you can never confuse the two. Cacao is brown foam, and Oakley is white foam, and it also has rubber in it. That's what the ball represents, because they added the sap of the rubber tree to these kind of potions. And this is really, it's very obvious what's going on here. It's tasting the potion, and he's giving the high sign. It's ready. You know, let's go for it. And this gives you an idea of the iconography associated with this. And this one seems to be loaded up with these florid hallucinogens, and specifically mushrooms, which those little dots represent, and the dot on there. And so my conjecture, which is not published, is that Oakley was parallel to cacao in a different ecosystem. The Aztec-type Nahua speakers imported cacao from around this area, from actually on the Guatemalan border, but it does not grow in Mesoamerica, per se. But they did use the potions, and so this was their analog for it, and I think the same situation prevails. The same inebriants were used in both, according to the type of purpose that was involved. Now, there's another goddess called Vlasoltheo, who's also associated with the agave, but also with inebriation in the moon. She has the yakamesli, but she has her mouth is always black, because she's the one who eats filth. And the Nahua speakers deified this, and especially the sopilote, the buzzard, the carrion eating animals, and so forth. Here you can see how they depict the sun and the moon together, and there you see they're sitting around a pot and drinking the potion, again the white foam and the flowers. And now, here you can see clearly the cacao potion with a brown foam, and then this white foam Oakley potion, and this is a funeral pyre. And these are Mixtec codices, by the way, from Oaxaca, pre-Columbian. And this woman, what the experts say, is stirring or frothing the potion. This is utter nonsense, because it doesn't need frothing. It makes froth all its own. It's cacao that is froth, and it's froth with a stick that you twirl between your hands, imparting a rotary motion of the head. And the original prototype of this is a small palm called tepejilote here, which they take a piece of stem that long with a root bundle sticking out about that big, cut off the rest of the roots, and that's the way the origin of these frothing sticks. But they have to be straight, or if it cavitates, it'll slop the thing around. And these, in this context, are always depicted as crooked or curved. And so iconographically here, they're emphasizing the point that what she's adding there with the stick is that curved stick there on top of the potion. And we now know what that is. And this is the possible connection with the material. It's this plant, which is to this day called palo de pulque, or the pulque stick. And its name is okpapli, which means the pulque drug in Nahua, or pulque medicine. And it's Acacia angustissima. And Acacia angustissima has only been reported in countercultural literature to contain active tryptamines. It's very common in North America, and in the United States in particular. This is some that I'm growing at my place in Jalapa. And it's the root again, like in Jordana, that is added to these potions. And this was known from the very first contact times. And the first of the Mesoamerican inebriants to be prohibited by the Spaniards was this plant. And this happened in 1539. There was a royal decree from Toledo saying that they could not cultivate this plant for fortifying this beverage called pulque. Already the word pulque had come into existence. And it was, nobody's tried this yet. This is up next for me as far as the bioassays go. And you can see some typical leguminous plant. Now, okay, so this okpapli needs to be studied. It's like an acacia angustissima, more carefully, chemically speaking, we're doing that. And also we need to bioassay this. This may be another situation where there's tryptamines in some bound form, like Jordana, that are orally active and don't need an MAO inhibitor, as is found in ayahuasca. Now, this again shows my Yahweh, and here you see the Yaka Mestri, this half-moon nose ring. And notice the potion down here. That's a cacao. That's very, no one disputes that that's a cacao fruit on top of it. And there you see the stick again. And moreover, she has two bundles of the sticks in her hand. And there's all kinds of stuff about these sticks. And nobody's ever picked up on this connection because they don't fixate on the inebriants at all. And this is a pipe being smoked over here with some entheogen in the smoke. But that clearly shows, and we saw another potion that shows the cacao and Oakley together. And so I think they're one and the same pharmacologically and symbolically, but they're just associated with different festivals and deities. But the same role, like ayahuasca, as an all-purpose vehicle for administering ordinary and extraordinary medicines. And here you can see, this is Xochiquetzal, with clearly an entheogenic cacao potion with a brown foam. And I don't have a slide of this, so I'll get one. There's another codex called the Vindobonensis, which I have a facsimile. And in two consecutive panels, the same scene with most of the same people are depicted. In one scene, you may have seen drawings or vignettes from this. There's a mushroom seance, and they're all holding pairs of mushrooms in their hands, and all these can be read. This is not a lost language. They're mnemonic pictograms to aid storytellers, and iconographically they're not so obscure. And in these side-by-side panels, facing the one with the mushrooms, there's the same scene, more or less repeated with agave, and you see the same thing with the stick. And two of the people are doing the same thing with putting the stick into the potion in the same ritual context. And so I'm really pretty sure about this parallelism. But we just need the bioassay and chemical information. Now, what were the inebriants added? Well, surely mushrooms, this is philosophy, Sir Lessons, held by Gordon Lawson in the 1950s here in Oaxaca. Also, this plant, which is called Foxyuitl in Nahuatl, the seed of which is called Oloyuki, contains lysergamids. Also, this was the most generally widespread shamanic inebriant in Mesoamerica at the time of the conquest, the most mentioned in the colonial literature and also in the Inquisition archives. Although today people accord it a secondary role, this was primary for the highland Mesoamericans compared to the mushroom and peyote.
What's the name of that one?
Turbina corymbosa. And it's called Coaxiuitl, which means the snake plant, or it's also called Quatlashoshoki, the green snake, and the seed is Ololuki, the little round thing.
Is Turbina the same as Rivea?
Yes. Rivea is in another name, but currently accepted taxonomy is Turbina corymbosa. And possibly this one in the Bombacaceae, Corariidea funebris, which is also associated to this day in Oaxaca with cacao potions, and is one that I'm reintroducing to my area because it's extinct in the wild in Mexico, and that's part of where I live. And more than likely, Salvia divinorum, which was probably in general use throughout Mesoamerica, and today only survives, so far as we know, in the Mazatec Sierra, where it does not seem to be traditional pre-contact, in my opinion. And here you can see it in flower. This is also growing in my place, which is only 150 kilometers north of Wildland, about the same ecosystem. And aqueous infusions of this rub the leaves in water, which is a highland Mesoamerican technique, or to this day made in the Mazatec Sierra. And it's a technique known for other plants, such as this one, tegetus, which is another lost inebriant. This is tegetus erecta, the common ornamental marigold, or the flower of the dead here associated with the Dia de los Difuntos. This is another lost entheogen. This is certainly an entheogen, and we don't really know, but it's still used by the Mihe, who also use this one, tegetus lucida, and the Huichol also use this one. So these tegetus barely survive as inebriants here. The Huichol mix it with tobacco.
What's it called?
Tegetus.
T
T-A-G-E-T-E-S, lucida, composite, composita. I don't have a picture of it in flower. And I think this is one of the last ones in the land, but I just wanted to show you, this is really an interesting, this is Xochipilli, the famous statue. And Xochipilli is widely regarded to be the lord of the inebriants, of the dance, of all the shamanic arts. But you see here a fairly good cross-section. It's sort of an iconographic association of this deity, Xochipilli, with the entheogens. You have the Ocli potion there with the pulque stick and the rubber. We don't know what the rubber connection is, but that's something that can certainly be studied. You have the rabbit over here. You have the mushroom glyphs along the border. And you have the flower coming right out of his mouth. And you have this lizard coming off of his penis. That's the very symbol of the Ololuki. The Queshpayi is another name for it, the lizard drug. And so that's very clearly associated with it also. And then I'm not sure what role exactly to ascribe to the bird head, but it must have an inebriating significance in this context. And I should mention that one of the Mesoamerican lost entheogens, I know of about a dozen of them, is a bird called Okonenyetu. And Okonenyetu, with the flesh of his bird, was clearly a vision drug. And we don't know what bird that is now, but that's something that remains to be looked into. But recently in New Guinea, some birds of the genus, I think Pitoi, were found that contained analogs of the batrachotoxins in their skin and feathers in very low levels. And these are found in higher levels in some species of dendrobated frogs, which is known generically as poison dart frogs, but only a couple species have ever been shown to be used in poison darts, and they are also visionary inebriants in their own right. But it's another topic. And I'll end on that note, and if anyone has strength for questions, I'll be happy to answer them. No, I mean they sell what is called the biscuit, but it's stem bark, and it's, the stem bark has been analyzed. It's been turned to contain DMT, but in very low levels, so under a tenth of a percent. And so I wouldn't recommend using that because it's stem bark. It's not root bark.
I've heard that Mexico is correct.
Pardon?
In Europe, the root people say that is not exportable from Mexico.
Well, that's news to me because I exported it from Oaxaca. In fact, Rob and I were the ones that introduced this to the market as an ayahuasca analog about 4 years ago. And now it's become the leading source. It's even being used by Dainista for Europe to make ayahuasca analogs because you can't get enough jungle monster from South America. One at a time.
Could it be mailed to America from Amsterdam?
Well, we export it out of here, yeah, all the time.
So it could be
Oh, yeah. The authorities don't know anything about this. Ayahuasca analogs, they don't know.
As far as the monoamine oxidase, is that present in large amounts of the stomach? That's why the harmaline needs to be taken?
Yeah.
It's also, of course, in the brain.
Yes, but in the brain, it's in the neuroglandins, and it's involved in intracellular metabolism. It's not a synaptic enzyme or an extracellular fluid.
So the harmaline doesn't make it to the brain, blood-brain barrier.
Definitely does. Well, something does. I mean, I don't know that for a fact, but it is psychoactive. Valium-like probably acts at the GABA-A receptor site as a chloride channel where the benzodiazepines bind the endogenous ligands, of which are one of them the beta carbon. So we know beta carbons can bind to that site. But no, if you take 60 milligrams of tourmaline by itself, you feel a distinct effect in about 45 minutes. Some of valium-like can last for many hours. And so, definitely, it does, it's also absorbed. But there, it's kind of working against it. That's what I'm saying. It's like taking valium and acid. And in fact, experimentally, it's been shown really clearly, and also it's been shown epidemiologically, that monoamine oxidase inhibitors, not beta carbon, but ones that are used in dysmine, inhibit dramatically the effects of DMT and LSD. So we have reason to believe from sketchy information from bioassays that they enhance the effects of epinephrine, like ecstasy.
Yeah,
people bandy around the word potentiation and say potentiation, but it's synergy, it's not potentiation. Because orally, and according to blood titers, DMT is much less active than it is injected, smoke, whatever it is.
You said that there was a use of people would chew on the coca plant or use the coca plant before using ayahuasca.
Yeah,
I'm not understanding. I mean, are you not supposed to use any kind of amphetamine or any kind of, or a coca plant when you're using an ayahuasca inhibitor?
Well,
I mean, I'm not
yes and no. I mean, all this literature about MAO inhibitors comes from therapeutic use of them in Western medicine. And the first one was tuberculosis remedy called itraniza that in the 50s was shown to produce euphoria in some subjects, and that's what led to this line of therapy of monoamine oxidase inhibition for psychiatric therapy or whatever they call it. And in fact, because of the connection between tyramine, which is a chemical name in foods, the dramatic reactions you get, there are all these warnings about beta carbamines and ayahuasca and tyramine and phenethylamines, but it's just there's no experiential evidence that I've heard for it, and I've combined all of these things and cocaine. I haven't tried amphetamines per se, but it synergizes beautifully with ayahuasca. It's part of the ayahuasca complex. And the phenethylamines that have been tried with ayahuasca or mescaline, I mean, in pharmawasca, that I know of, mescaline, TMA2, and ecstasy. And
really?
No untoward effects have been reported. And ask Sasha Shulgin, I don't think he would agree with me that there's no reason for these warnings. And let me explain. What's that?
I heard that the MDMA and mescaline were the biggest no-nos when you're using.
No, I'd say it's just the opposite. You can probably get by in half the dose of both of those by combining it with beta carbon. But the reason for this warning situation is that people have extrapolated. They know about the ayahuasca diet and so forth, and they know about the dietary importance when you're taking these MAO inhibitors. But remember, the ayahuasca diet is no different, really, than the mushroom diet and the salvative norm diet. It's a spiritual cleansing diet, and it has nothing to do with any particular interaction between things in food and the ayahuasca, but rather purifying the body before taking the ayahuasca, and that's another subject, which I wouldn't comment on because I wouldn't, you know, be able to. So now, in the case of the medicinal MAO inhibitors, now there are many others, of which you probably heard of moclobemide, which is a reversible inhibitor. But for many years, when all of this literature was generated, the only ones available were irreversible inhibitors, which bind irreversibly to MAO. And again, the effect that's being sought there is in the nerve terminals in the brain to affect the metabolism of not in the gut. Although these things work in the gut, and I've made pharmawasca from isocarboxazide, which is an isoxazole MAO inhibitor. It works fine. It's more potent than the beta carbon. And I know for a fact from other reports that moclobemide, which is a reversible inhibitor, also works in pharmawasca. But somewhat higher doses than the beta-carbolene. But the beta-carbolenes are short-acting, reversible inhibitors that are obviously absorbed from the stomach really quickly because you can feel the effect in about 45 minutes and probably cleared from the stomach completely by a couple of hours. And so it doesn't really follow to compare these two. So I just have done it experimentally and in the course of my ayahuasca analog experiments and pharmawasca experiments, even during the effects, eating all the no-no foods and so on and so forth, and I've used extensive amounts of coca and cocaine both in this context to see the particular synergy. And there is a synergy. There is a definite synergy between the stimulants, both the probably it would be the same with amphetamines, I don't know. And remember, they add caffeine also to these brews, another stimulant, and coca. And so it's works great.
But like you said, you talked before that every body is different. That what works for you could be what's not a normal for you could be a very big normal for me.
So yeah, that's true.
So I should still, of course, use caution.
No, absolutely. Definitely. But I'm just saying that there's no reason to make this connection. It's just that because of the fact that there was this diet associated with ayahuasca. But some of the foods that they can take are ones that are not, you know, so good if they're on medicinal MAO inhibitors. And then this fact of, you know, using these far more toxic compounds, really, to achieve a very high level of MAO inhibition in the brain. And we're just talking about transient MAO inhibition in the gut for 1 hour. And that's pretty much what you get in the beta carbolase, minimal, you know, sundering effect. It's transient also. But I always, generally, as a good rule of thumb, I don't have to take these things with food in my stomach anyway, because it doesn't feel good. It's best to fast the day at least before taking them. And I generally don't want to eat until substantially after the effect. But once the psychoactive effect dissipates, there's not going to be any MAO inhibition in the gut, basically. And very little in the brain. Anybody else ever hear?
Yeah. You mentioned the
mocolabenamide.
Yes. Have you used that with the DMT source, like the mosaicillus?
I haven't personally. No, I haven't personally, but I met an Australian man in Amsterdam who's done extensive experimentation with that, and he gave me detailed notes on it.